never let a brother or sister fall and risk telling the truth. You were telling the truth. Next slide. I quote the scripture. I love this one. If there be a controversy between men and they come unto the judgment, your leadership is the judges. So when there's an issue arise and you come to Samaka, come to Lamar, come to Kanukia, or come to another leader or elder in the community, look what the scripture is saying. That the judges, what? May judge what them. Then they should justify the righteous and condemn the wicked. That's a commandment. That's a law. Our job as leaders to do what? Condemn that wicked brother. But they left out the sister. Two, then it should be if the wicked man deserves to be beaten. Come on now. Come on now. So you can beat your daughter, you can beat your son. Oh, but I'm 40, I'm 50 years old. No, the scripture, that scripture is care never our age. Care that much age. That the judge will cause him to lie down. And, let me start with that. Some people need to be beat. Remember, what stays in the house stays in the house.
That's right.
Let me say it again. What stays in the community stays in the community. So if Baruch had to say, come in. Somebody take up a better man. If Baruch had to say, come in. Lay on your back. Don't get so offended. There go my sword ready. You got a problem beating you? You got a problem right here? You beat your woman. Oh, babe, I love you tonight. Now you're playing hypocrite. You can't want to beat in the bedroom, spank the baby. And then when they cut this wall, oh, don't, hey, brother, don't beat me. You hypocrite. Come on now. Oh, the mic acting up against it on like that. That the judge will cause him to lay down and be beaten in the presence according to his gift with a certain number of blows. 3, 40 blows he may give him and no more least. He should see this and beat him with many blows above these, and your what? Your brother be humiliated in your sight. Don't give him no more than that. Give him what he needs. If you're not going to apply with Israel, stop disciplining your church. Next slide. That's what it did to us in slavery. We got beat into submission. So when your moral have the power check you, stop getting so offended. He love you. He pray for you. He fast for you. Do what does say Yah. All that he wants you to do is do what Yah said do.
Alright.
Yes, sir.
The difference is that they
humiliate us. Okay, that's right. Tie us to a pole and beat the living blood out of us. Now guarantee Nashabot, if Baruch said, come here, you know what, you were acting up. Here I got a whip right here on my side. Y'all can call 911. Portsmouth police will be up here. This man ain't gonna beat me. Oh no, master. Next slide. The end. That's it. Pray my script for y'all.
This time we're gonna go ahead and get the four A speak for just 10 minutes. I'm gonna start it off. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom.
Are you all right?
All right.
Shia didn't scare you, did he? You didn't scare me. He really a teddy bear. I'm trying to tell you. That's my op, though. That's my op. I'm going to go ahead and start with my 10 minutes briefly. These are times of change. You know, even Israel, they're saying at the end of the era, it's the end of the era. So at the end of anything, that means it's the beginning of something else, correct? So I just want to go into something real brief. I ain't even got my bag on my scriptures. I've been running around, but not to say, go to Yirmiyahu chapter 24. And if this is my 10 minutes, if this is my final 10 minutes, my last response, my last words to you, I just want to read something about what the prophet said. And I was explaining to the people last night, the perspective of our people, it varies based on captivity, being here, being brought over here on ships, and being a product of the curse, and so forth and so on. But I just want to see what our prophets say. Our prophets are our God. They're our eyes, they're our ears. It says the chaza is our ears. It says the rea is our eyes, according to the prophet Yeshua, Nabi Yeshua. So we have to take what they say, and we have to bring it into practical application, literal meaning of practical application here today. What are we seeing? What are they saying to us? Because their words are timeless. What are they saying to us? All right? Let's go to 24. Let's just start at verse 1. And I just want to do a quick breakdown, like I said. 10 minutes, quick breakdown. And maybe at the end, maybe you'll look at something a little different.
Jeremiah, or Jeremiah chapter 24, verse 1. Yahuwah showed me, and look, there were two baskets of figs set before the haycock of Yahuwah.
Two baskets, right? All right.
After Nebuchadnezzar, sovereign of Babel, had exiled Jeconiah, son of Jehoiakim, sovereign of Yehuda, and the heads of Yehuda with the craftsmen and smiths.
So it was two sets of what? Figs. In what? Set before, actually not in, but set before the what? The Hakal, which is the house of the temple, all right? Okay, go ahead.
From Yerushalayim, and had brought them to Babel. Verse 2, one basket had very good figs, like the figs that are first ripe, and the other basket had very spoiled figs, which could not be eaten. They were so spoiled.
Okay, so one basket had very good figs, right? And the other basket had very spoiled figs. In the Hebrew, they use the term ra. Who knows what the word ra means? Evil, what else? Bad, wicked, referred to, right? So one had very good figs, the other one had evil figs, or raw figs, wicked figs, okay? Two baskets, keep going.
Verse 3, and Yahuwah said to me, what do you see, Jeremiah? And I said, figs, the good figs, very good, and the spoil, very spoiled, which could not be eaten. They are so spoiled. Again, the word of Yahuwah came to me, saying, thus said Yahuwah, the Elohim of Israel, like these good figs, so do I acknowledge the exiles of Yehuda, whom I have sent out of this place for their own good.
Okay, so then he said the Bar Elohim, or the Bar of Yah, came to him, right? So it's like saying, like the understanding came to me, right? And then said to me, or explained to me, that these good figs are what? What are these good figs? Read that again.
The figs are good figs, very good.
Very good,
And the spoil, very spoiled, which cannot be eaten. They are so spoiled. Mm-hmm. Like these good figs, so do I acknowledge the exiles of Yehuda, whom I have sent out of this place for their own good.
So he said, like these good figs, do I do what? Acknowledge what?
The exiles of Yehuda.
The exiles of Yehuda. Mm-hmm. Okay, pay attention to that. Keep going out.
Verse 6, and I shall set my eyes on them for good.
Okay, so he says, and I shall set my eyes on them for good. Now, a lot of you are here today, and were you asking for truth? Were you seeking truth? Mm. Or did truth come and find you somehow? Or did you just end up in a situation where you was on a bus, or you was in a school, you was in a place, and somebody said something to you, or you saw something that drew you, and it sparked your interest, or your attention? Most High said, these good figs, he said, I set my eyes on them for good. I fix my eyes on my attention. I'm watching them for good, right? Okay, keep on.
And shall bring them back to this land.
Uh-huh.
And I shall build them and not pull them down. And shall plant them and not pluck them up.
Uh-huh.
And I shall give them a heart to know me, that I am Yahweh.
Oh, he says, and I will give them a heart to know me.
Come on, come on.
See, you might have thought that you were just seeking him, right? Or that you had it, or yeah, man, I always seek wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. But the Most High says, I'll give them a heart to want to know you.
Mm-hmm.
I'll make your heart into this. I'll build you up. But he said, I sent you into there for your own good. So oftentimes we like, well, this, that, and the other thing, the forefathers, yeah, that has some validity to it, but ultimately is that it's for our own good. If you are good, if you're the good figs. Or you might be, you might not be. You might be the wicked figs. We're gonna get to them in a second. But can you read it?
And they shall be my people, and I shall be their Elohim. For they shall turn back to me with all their heart.
Mm.
And as a spoiled figs, that could not
okay,
be.
So, hold that. So, the Most High said, I sent them into captivity for their own good.
Mm-hmm.
How could that be good? How could that be for your own good that he sent you here?
Mm-hmm.
That you're in a situation that you, how could it be for your own good? Why not just leave you where you was at?
Come on.
Why did he just leave you in the spaces where we was at? We was in our land, with our people. What happens when you're dealing with fruit, right? What happens when you mix spoilt with good fruit?
Spoil the whole batch.
Come on, out.
So, in essence, the separation was necessary. See, the Most High already told us he's going to sift the house of Israel, but not one. Those grains going to fall, right? But he's going to sift it. So it was necessary. So although being in the curse or being a product of the curses that came through the transgressions of the nation, he's still watching after you.
Hallelujah.
And you don't have to be like what's happening to the wicked.
Come on.
To the wicked figs, which we're about to get to. You don't have to be the wicked fig. We just going through this because of the curses. This is just happening because, you know, we cursed it. There's no way to get out of it. The curses attach to the individual. Now, as a nation, we're dealing with two different stories here. As a nation, yes, the nation has been exiled. The nation is this, but the curses attach to a certain type of individual. That's why when you read Deuteronomy 28, it says what? If you do this, if you do that, then this will happen, and this will happen, and that will happen. So in essence, if you don't do that, then what will happen? So when the Creator says, in the places that I send you, I'm going to the prophet Yekezekel, he said, the places that I send you, I'm going to be a little mikdos, or a tabernacle amongst you. Who is he talking to? What type of people are he talking to? So I'm seeing two Israels. There's two. Read about the bad figs. I'm almost done.
Verse 8. And as the spoiled figs that cannot be eaten because they are so spoiled, for thus said Yahweh, so do I give up Zedekiah, the
uh-huh.
sovereign of Yehuda,
uh-huh.
his heads, the rest of Jerusalem who remain in this land, and those who dwell in the land of Mitzrayim.
Oh, he said, Zedekiah, his heads, right? And who else?
Jeconiah.
Jehoiakim. Jehoiakim. The kings, the leaders, right? And who else?
His heads.
The heads.
The rest of Jerusalem.
The rest of Jerusalem. That's the mother of the nation. That's where the leaders are at.
Those who dwell in Mitzrayim.
And those who dwell in Mitzrayim. Those who went down to Mitzrayim thinking they were going to be saved. But because you was wicked, you're not going to be safe. So if you're wicked, no matter where you flee, guess what's going to follow you?
instructions.
Because you were wicked, because you created wickedness, wickedness now pursues you. No matter what assembly, no matter what kind of people you get around the Gentiles, and they know you wicked. They like, this ain't right with that guy. They know you wicked.
Come on.
Because wickedness follows those who are being wicked. As a man sowed, so shall he what?
Reap.
You might be reaping it because you sold it. I done been through it, and I go through it. I'm still reaping from some of the stuff I sold back in the days.
That's
right. I'm like, golly. Still coming up. Still popping up. Now read what else happens to them.
Verse 9.
Uh-huh.
And I shall make them a horror to all the reigns of the earth.
I shall make who a horror? The good things or the bad things?
Bad things.
That's what the Creator says. I shall make them a horror. What else?
For evil. To be a reproach and a byword.
That sounds familiar, right? Where else you read about that byword? Babylon, right? Keep going.
A mockery.
A mockery. Read that before, right? What is that? Part of the curses, right?
Mm-hmm.
What else?
And a curse.
And a curse. He said, you're going to be a curse. You're cursed because you are the curse. See how that law works? That law of balance works? You are the curse, so you're cursed. Keep going.
In all the places to which I drive them,
uh-huh.
And I shall send a sword, the scarcity of food,
right.
And the pestilence among them,
uh-huh.
Till they are consumed from the land that I gave them, gave to them and their fathers.
Don't we read about the pestilence? Don't we read about the sword? And all these things pursuing those who what? Do not keep the commands. Do not cling to the covenant.
Okay.
Who do not cling to the covenant. So if it's pursuing you, maybe it's because of what you were doing when you wasn't clinging to the covenant. But you don't have to be a product of that anymore. Brother told me, my aunt told me, Menashe, he said, you know, the reward of keeping one command, that what? You keep another one. And vice versa, when you don't keep a command, you end up not keeping another one.
Amen.
It's a cycle. So, I'm going to ask you today, which basket are you in?
Come on.
What basket are you in? Which one? Be honest with yourself. Which basket are you sitting in right now? Are you a little right? Are you going to be the blessing or are you going to be the curse? Which one are you going to be? Will you be the blessing or will you be the curse? Moshe said, I set before you today what? Life and good? Death and evil? Choose. Which one will you be today? It's your choice. He gave you the choice. Therefore what? Choose life. So he gave you, he asked which one would you choose, and then he told you which one to choose.
Hey.
He says you have a choice, but choose life. Be the good figs in captivity so that the Most High can be a little tabernacle with you. See, in his tabernacle, there's protection. In his tabernacle is Yahusha, or salvation. That's what's in his tabernacle. All the things that pertain to him are in his tabernacle. Choice is yours. That's my 10 minutes.
Well, you see, I'm coming up empty hands. No, well, empty hands. So we got about, let's see, I wish you had some seconds on this, I could get some exact time. But my assignment today is a little bit different. I have to tell you what he showed me while we were praying. I'm like, okay, Father, here we go. So we were in the back and I had no idea we were going to have to speak for 10 minutes. So. Or 10 minutes or less, is that correct?
Yeah.
10 minutes or less, all right. And so as we begin to pray, I begin to see, and it was a beaver's den that was built over
running water. And I didn't quite understand, so I said, okay, fine, I'm just going to work with it. Whatever you show me, I'll tell the people. So, you know, as I just sit and meditate, he began to reveal some things to me. And so we're going to just talk just for a few minutes about the characteristic of a beaver. And you might even look beside you because you might have a beaver sitting beside you. Now, what's the first thing that a beaver listens for? Running water. Or living water. Remember what the Mashiach said. The Mashiach said, if you believe on me as the scriptures have said, out of your belly shall flow rivers of what? Not dead water, but living water. And what the beaver does, the beaver targets where it hears living water. And he builds his dam because he doesn't want that water to flow in your life. Have you ever run into a situation where things just seem to be turning around, and all of a sudden everything just started to come your way, pile up on you, come against you, all kind of obstacles? That's the spiritual beaver at work. Sometimes it can work through the spiritual realm. Sometimes it can be people. People that you haven't heard from in such a long time. You going through, all of a sudden they show up. How you feeling, brother? They know you're not feeling good. But see, what we've got to do, we've got to be on constant alert. Because running water, living water, most of us have been to the James River, experienced it. When the James River is flowing, if you can't see it, you can hear it. So ask your neighbor, say, neighbor, can you hear that living water? Every last one of us should have some water in here flowing today. That's what makes praising him so wonderful. Got the beaver on your back. He's trying to block your flow. So what are you going to do? Are you going to sit there and let the beaver hinder you, hamper you, prevent you, keep you from getting where you need to go and what you need to do? He's listening for the flowing water. Is your water flowing? Everybody just close your eyes for a second. Can you hear the water flow? It says in John, 1 John, there are three that bear record on earth, or witness on earth. The Ruach, the water, and the blood. You can open your eyes now. And I'm out finished. I'm almost there, bro. Yeah. When we went to Israel, one of the things we discovered that they won't, you know, they keep it hidden. That's one of the secrets of finding where the temple actually existed. Because now we're supposed to be a temple of the Ruach HaKodesh. Is not correct? Is that correct? The temple sat over top of water. In order to accommodate the blood, there had to be a lot of water flowing. So there are three things that's got to be a witness in your life. You've got to have the blood, you've got to have the Ruach, and you've got to have that water flow. So don't be satisfied with a trickle. Some people like the trickle. You know, even the beaver dam will let a little bit of water come through. But you want it to flow. Just touch somebody and say, let it flow. Don't be scared. Y'all scared of me. It's supposed to be a beaver. Brother, let it flow. Hallelujah. But you got to let it flow. Don't be scared to let the Father flow in your life. And when he flows, be who you are. Don't be someone else. Let him flow in your life and you be who you are. operate according to how he gives it to you and not someone else. Let it flow and we all will be happy. So that's my 10 minutes.
Dance? My 10 minutes just starts with the snack. Okay, well, while he's setting up, I'm a little bit, I guess the word is unconventional, not traditional as far as a teacher. Mori Kazakia, what I have to implore to everyone, if this is the last time you ever see me or I ever see you, as a more, we're supposed to guide you in a direction. And as our brother said earlier, every more has a different way of teaching, but we're all achad when it comes to the word of the Most High. Alright? Okay, so some of you might be offended, some of you may not. Everybody in here is not on the same page. When you come into a classroom, everybody starts at a different level, level of understanding. So bear with me. Yisrael now. All right? Next slide. All right. You may disagree with the order that I have up here. You have the Creator, the people, king, priest, leaders, the nations. Do you agree that's the theme of the Tanakh? That's the theme of the scripture. If you don't agree, raise your hand. Next slide. If I'm in your way, just tell me. You can learn a lot from a dummy.
Hey.
All right. You can learn something from everyone. All right. And some of you may disagree. He may not be a dummy to you. You know. Next slide. But you can be inspired by Trump, and if you listen to what he says, you have to think. He said, let's make America great again.
All right.
Mm-hmm. All right, so I'm going to ask you, those of you enlightened, awakened Hebrews, when was America great?
We were slaves.
And who was America great for when it was great? Salah. Think about it. Think about it. Now, is everybody present? Can you hear my voice? Are you thinking about yesterday? Are you thinking about tomorrow? Are you with me right now? Okay, next slide. I hear a lot of people talking about, you know, you got a lot of Hebrews on the street trying to reach the people. And for the last couple of months, I've been dealing with thoughts and things pertaining to the nation. All right, so I'm gonna ask you, and you can answer, but remember, I only have 10 minutes. When was Israel great? And who was Israel great for or to? Yes.
When Dawid took the kingdom.
So Israel was great when Dawid took the kingdom. We had a lot of war, a lot of blood, right?
Yeah.
Okay. That's a good answer. It's not a bad answer. Anyone else want to ask?
When they crossed over the Jordan and into the land. Israel was great during that time period.
And okay.
It was great for the people or for the Most High's name at the time.
Okay.
Yeah, cool.
We were great whenever we were obedient. And we were great for the world.
Say it again.
We were great whenever we were obedient and we were great for the world.
We were great whenever we were obedient and we were great for the world. Somebody had their hand up over here?
Yeah, I mean, he pretty much said what I was going to say. But if you notice, whenever we was keeping the laws, the Most High lift Israel up. But whenever you straight away, the surrounding nations always conquered us. So it's coinciding with the brother who sent.
Like discipline.
So whenever you are doing what the Most High wants you to do, you should be great.
Right.
Elder.
Beyond great.
I say we were great when Yah was our king.
When Yah was our king.
He's always.
All right, wake up. Wake up. All right, and Salah, think about that. Wake up. What's he talking about? Next slide. Are you living in the past? So we're going to look at Yirmiyahu or Jeremiah, chapter 6, verse 16. Thus says Yahweh, stand ye in the ways and see, and ask for the old path, where it is the good way, and walk therein, and ye shall find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not walk therein. What does Jeremiah 6 and 16 mean to you? And this is a question. Think about it. Everybody says, seek the old path. You hear Morey say it, you know, Zocaine, so on and so forth say it. Are you living in the past? Are you remembering principles that allow you to live and apply them in the now or the present? I hear people say, we're in a curse. And this is kind of going in line with what Morey said. I didn't even know he was going to go that way. We're in the curse. But the Most High said, do good and live, right? Do ra and what? He gave it to you. Next slide. And this might be a food talk too, so. Are you living in the future? Are you suffering and going through now with your eyes and thoughts on the future? Oh, you know, yeah, we in the curse, so, you know, we got to go through. But it's going to get better. Oh, I got to just, you know, just wait. Are you waiting for someone or something to deliver you from your present condition? Mm-hmm. Are you daydreaming about having the nations bowing at your feet? Yes, I'm talking to you. It's pertaining to somebody. Come on. Proverbs 27 and 1. Boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day might bring forth.
Come on.
All right? Is your reality based on the past? Is your reality based on the future? I'm going to ask you a question. With all the things that you see on social media and on the television, what can you say you have intimacy with that it affects you as an individual? Or are you creating a reality based on something you never even experienced yourself? Mm-hmm. Next slide. The kingdom of Yahweh is now. You've been given the Tanakh. You've been given the Tanakh. You have the laws, which are instructions. You have statutes and you have judgments, which is your sense. You should have sense. Genesis 4 and 6, and Yahweh said unto Cain, why art thou wroth? And why is thy countenance fallen? If thou dost well, thou shalt not be accepted. And thou dost not well, sin lieth at the door. And unto thee be his or it in the Hebrew, who? And it shall rule over him. The opportunity for transgression or sin is always present. It's always present. You have a choice. You always have a choice. You can keep the law or you cannot keep the law. Stop making excuses. Stop making excuses. Excuses is for the past or for the future. And guess what? They really don't exist because all you can live is now. Next slide.
You're getting close.
I'm getting close. Why
are you? You get a more in-house pass.
And I'm asking you, and think about it. You don't have to answer this. Why, if you're going through something right now, why are you going through it? Who did it to you? And this is the theme of tonight. Clear, consistent, very consistent. Anything that's gonna that pertains to you, salvation and so on, is clear and consistent and exhaustive, meaning it's thorough.
Right.
It repeats itself, it's repetitive. Exodus 14 and 15, and Yahweh said unto Moshe, wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak to the children of Israel that they go forward. What you crying about? What are you crying about, Israel? Yisrael?
Come on, huh?
My ox said, the Most High shall be a mikdosh. Sleek up. A mikdosh. Where? Are you looking outside yourself? Are you looking somewhere? Where's the mikdosh at? Where's the mikdosh? See, I have set before thee this day life and good and death and evil, in that I command thee this day to love Yahweh thy El, to walk. To walk. Not to well, I'm going to start tomorrow. I just got to make sure I take care of this. You know, and because of this happened yesterday, you know, I'll probably have to start next week on. No, he says to walk in his ways and keep his commands and his statutes and his judgment that thou may live and multiply. And Yahweh will bless you in the land where you go to possess. Next slide. Salah, are you with me? Are you still present? Some of y'all was thinking about something that happened yesterday. Some of y'all was thinking about something that you're going to do tomorrow. Man, it's going to be a long ride back home, wherever I came from. Come on. Change your mind. You, as a conscious, what does conscious mean? Somebody give me an answer. Awake. Or you should be. Israelite, have, not looking for, waiting for, you have the means to change your situation now. Next slide. What are you doing to manifest the kingdom? Are you waiting for the kingdom to come? Are you waiting? It's coming. It's coming. But even when it comes, you have to be identified to be a servant in the kingdom. So what are you doing now? You reap what you sow. Right? You reap what you sow. So whatever you're going through now, it could be catching up to you from before, whether for Tov or for Ra. We all are under the Bar Elohim, the matters or the things of Yahweh. Right? Tov and Ra, think of a battery, a plus and a negative. It's all different degrees of the same thing, the Bar Elohim. Different degrees of the same thing. And if they should confess their iniquity, and the iniquity of their fathers with their trespass, which they trespass against me, and that also they have walked contrary unto me, and that I also have walked contrary unto them, and have brought them into the land of their enemies, if their uncircumcised heart be humble, and I'm going to ask for a request later on, is okay? You know that song. And they then accept of the punishment. Maruka always says it. Maury Baruch always says, you know, you shouldn't be, if you put your child on punishment, they shouldn't be on the street saying, you the devil, you this, you that, you that. You're supposed to be salah, meditating on what you did, on what you're doing to fix what you did. All right? Then will I remember my covenant with Yaakov and also my covenant with Yitzchak and also my covenant with Abraham? Will I remember? And I will remember the land. Stop using yesteryear as your excuse for your current condition. Be present. Live now. That's my time. Yeah. Right.
Shabbat shalom. Everybody still talk?
Okay,
I got 10 minutes, so I'm only gonna ask you two questions. Okay, two questions. I'm already Malakia. All right. So my first question is, in theme of everything that we've been talking about, my brother brought out judgment, leadership. Adon Baruch brought out good things, bad things, right? And then Adon Medeya, he brought out about the characteristics of a beaver, living water, right? And then Kazakia talks about changing your present situation by keeping the laws, statutes, and commandments of the Most High, right? Okay, I'll talk about it. All right, so with that being said, right, this is the question I have for everybody. What type of ruach do you have? Okay. So in everything that's going on, what type of ruach do you have? And I believe everybody here knows what type of ruach they possess within themselves. Okay. Is it Tov? Is it Ra? Or you just don't, you know, maybe you don't know. Okay. What type of ruach do you have?
How many?
Or how many do you have? Or do you even know what a ruach is? Would you know it if you saw it? Would you recognize it if you heard it? Are you defined by that ruach? Okay. Two scriptures, really quick. Bamidbar, Numbers, chapter 14, really quick. Alright, Bamidbar chapter 14, and I'm going to read verse 24.
Bamidbar, or Numbers, chapter 13, verse 24. That place was called the Valley of Eshcol. Bamidbar, or Numbers, chapter 14, verse 24. But my servant, Caleb, because he has had a different ruach, and has followed me fully, I will bring him to the land which he entered, and his descendants shall take possession of it.
Okay, so it says that Caleb had a different ruach. What was his ruach? Said righteous? Okay, anybody else?
Obedient. Trusting.
I think I heard Adon Tazadaq say we were great. What was it? No, it was okay, I'm sorry. We were great when Yah was our king. We were great when we were obedient, right? It said this brother right here had was read in the Hebrew as a ruach akonet. Anybody know what that means? All right, root word akar. Same word you see in the first mitzvah. Okay, akar means to delay, take your time, or hinder, right? So in other words, the ruach that Caleb had was nothing delayed him in following the Most High. Nothing. Which is why it was different. Y'all know the story with everybody else, right? Everybody else had pretty much the same ruach. Right, and we see what happened. Okay. Is it befitting that that's the same thing that you see today? Right? While we still at a standstill? Everybody follow? So I ask you again, what ruach do you have? Do you have the ruach to follow the Most High? Okay. His laws, his statutes, his commandments. Not mine. Not Morey Shail, Lamad, Canute, the Most High. And understand that the Most High allows his servants, right, to bring forth Dabar Elohim. Which we all define by that, right? Mm-hmm. All right, that's simply the matter of Elohim. Okay? My second question. How many people love the commands of the Creator?
Hey, very.
Show of hands. I ain't gonna let y'all tell you. Okay, I saw this half of the room. What's going on this side of the room? Did I see all the hands on this side of the room?
Oh, yeah. Trick question.
Okay. So everybody in this room emphatically loves the commands of the Creator. Yes? Okay? Okay. Let's go to Joshua chapter 24. Real quick. Joshua chapter 24 and verse 22.
Joshua chapter 24, verse 22. Joshua said to the people, you are witnesses against yourselves.
You are that you a have witness against yourself. Okay? So, you said that you love the commands of the Creator. You said that you love your brother as you love yourself. You said that you want to serve Yah, right? We've all said that at some point in this walk, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so do you recount those same words maybe tomorrow, right? Or maybe a year from now? Or do you remember that, you know, that which you said a time ago in reference to following the Creator? Okay. There's so many ruachs that's rising as of right now, right? And it's very easy to become distracted. It's very easy to turn away from your brother or your sister for whatever the reason. But if we have the same Ruach, and what I mean by that is the Ruach to follow Yah, then we don't have an excuse. There is no excuse. Because in following Yah, we have a duty to each other. Everybody following that? At all times. Two reasons why we over here that I want to emphasize on. One, we went into idolatry, right?
Okay.
And the second one, we didn't take care of each other.
Yeah.
And we still don't take care of each other. That has to change. So if you say you have the right Ruach, or as you know, Caleb had a different Ruach, as opposed to what we see, because everybody's seen something different. That triggers something in your mind to say, you know what? We need to do some correcting here. And then once you acknowledge that correction, right, then you become a witness against yourself.
You are witnesses against yourselves, that you have chosen for yourselves Yahuwah.
So nobody made you do that.
Go ahead. To serve him. And they said, we are witnesses.
They said what?
We are witnesses.
They are a witness. Okay. So in all that I have to say is that just Zakar, remember, right? Remember that you are a witness against yourself. Remember what Yah gave you. Because he didn't have to do that at all. He even had to give you the opportunity to know who he was. Just look at our people that don't know. Everybody following that? Okay. These words are life. These words that were given to us, they are your life. They are the length of your days. Right? You, so you can live, and who else can live? Your descendants. Right? We all supposed to be a nation of what?
Priests.
And the priest should always keep what at the forefront. Instruction. Torah. At all times. Torah.
I want everybody to say something to themselves. I witness against myself. And then when they say it, internalize it, and ask who is the I and who is myself.
Okay. Everybody heard what the I said? Okay. And that's my 10 minutes.
Okay. Hell yeah. Hell yeah.
Shalom.
Shalom.
How you guys doing?
Good.
All right, so I have to say, first, I was not prepared. I'm going to try and give you guys what y'all gave me a couple weeks back. All right? So first thing I want to say is before I'm a leader, before I'm looked at as a teacher, I'm first a servant. Okay, I'm a servant to y'all. I'm a servant to all my brothers. I'm built with every single one of you here. And so you know what's in me. I know what's in you guys. I want to say hello, Yah, and Torah, Yah. All right? Now, the type of person that I am, I'm looking for everything in action. I want to see things done practically. And so, Yah's been moving differently with us in D.C. I won't say than anybody else, but there's definitely a Ruach going forth right now. We had Shaul bring out judgment, which was the same, ironically, not ironically, but the same message that was brought out there in Terroir. Okay, so this is the second witness. All right, and what I'm going to tell you guys is going to go in that same exact vein, right? So, in thinking about what I was going to come up here and talk to you guys about, I remembered a dream that I had about 3 weeks ago. So, in the dream, it's a long dream, so I'm going to try and sum it up as quickly as possible. All right, in the dream, the whole city in D.C. was closed off, and they were going to different spots where there were tunnels that go underground, and they were sealing the tunnels. Now, there was a documentary crew going through the city documenting this because it was a big controversy. The seals were time sensitive. So while there were people under there doing things underground in the darkness, it needed to be sealed at a certain time, and it was so pressing that we were going to seal someone down there. At the last minute, that person came up, and we let him out, and there was a vagrant who was passing by and saw us sealing the seal. He said, or a man that was sealing with us, looked at him and said, we're going to throw you down there next. And he said, no, don't throw me down there, because if you do, this is the vagrant speaking, if you do, I will change. At that point, I looked the man in his eyes, and his eyes start changing, his teeth turn jagged. And I don't know if you guys have been in the presence of certain entities, but shapeshifters, face changers, that's usually the sign or a mark of a shoulder or a demon. Okay? So I've had that in my dreams plenty of times. So I knew what I was dealing with instantly. So I told the guy, leave him alone, let him go about his business. Come to find out, this same guy who didn't want to go in the darkness ends up trying to sneak his way back in there. Something about the darkness was appealing to him. So he wanted to go back down in the sewers. He found a back way in. And then later I exposed him. He had two cronies. There's more in this dream. I'm just trying to give you guys a synopsis. He had two friends who, upon my pointing him out, went and grabbed my left side. Do we know the difference between left and right? Okay. So they grabbed my left side and they were holding me down. I was attempting to bring forth the judgment, bring this man out of the darkness, but he wanted to be down there. And his two friends were holding me, two spirits now, which are going forth Israel, going through Israel, holding me back. Then one of my own brothers, right? This is a little bit down the way. So these two men are holding me down. And then I get up and I say, okay, I'm going to get ready to judge all you guys. I was getting ready to fight them. Okay. Then my own brother comes and he says, no, don't fight them. And he's holding me back. The man with the shoulder with the demon on his face comes right at me, and I punched him right in the face, and the demon got knocked right off, right? I didn't punch him as hard as I could, though, okay? I only punched him hard enough to put the demon off him, right? And I knew if I had punched him as hard as I could, he would die, okay? So do we know the difference between left and right yet? Okay? All right. So continuing, his two friends are continuing to attack me, and my own brother comes and says, no, you know, don't fight them. I said, you're holding me back, and by holding me back, you're putting the rest of us in jeopardy, right? Because I can't bring forth the judgment now and defend myself and defend those who are at the whim of these people, and they won't stop attacking. So they continue to attack me, and I fight the guy off of me, fight my own brother off of me. I didn't hit him, but I used all of my strength to throw him down. And when I threw him down, I kept that strength in my fist, and I hit the next guy, and he died. Right? So this dream was troubling to me, man. I called Canuck, I called my other Ak Daoud, he's not here today. I'm trying to figure out what's going on in this dream. What was revealed is that there are people among us who continue to want to operate in darkness. They want to go back to the ways that they were, right? And they can't make up their mind as to who they really want to serve. They have two, right? Second thing that was revealed to me is that there are those among our own nation who are holding back judgment, because they are scared. We're in fear of the judgment. Mm-hmm. Right? And when this man who was of our own tribe held back the judgment came out too strong and killed the guy. When if I could have hit him the way I wanted to, I could have just knocked the shoulder off. Right? So one thing I want us to think about is, one, are we judging ourselves first and foremost? Are we judging our houses second? And what are we yielding our members to? Okay? Because one of the hardest things it is to do in this existence is to walk as a vessel unto the Most High. Yeah, because don't get it wrong, we are no more than that. You're a vessel, I'm a vessel. And whatever you yield yourself to is what you're going to bear fruit. Okay. When you read in the Dead Sea Scrolls, there's how many spirits? What are the two? Tob and Rob. There's truth and injustice, truth and falsehood. Okay. Both work in a man, but how do you know which one's working at that time? We have these people in our nation who do need deliverance, but we also have people who we have to keep at a distance and learn their ways, right? And when the judgment comes forth, don't be fearful of it. Maisha had another dream where I was going to bring rebuke to two rebellious women, or a woman and her daughter. One, I had two paddles. One paddle was 12 strikes for the woman. What does 12 mean? And the other paddle was 9 strikes. Right? In the dream, when I couldn't hit with my left hand, the left hand was the mercy. Time for mercy is coming to a close. Mm-hmm. Right? And we know that in Hazon, or Revelations, which is really just a rehashing of 2nd Ezra, right? It says that there is a seal that's broken, and the black horse rides forth with scales. What do scales? scales. What are scales? What do those represent? They represent judgment. On the right, right, mercy on the left. And a false balance is
condemnation.
Okay? So my last words to you guys are to one, hazinu, right? Here, but here in the sense that you're when. What's the judgment? What's the mercy? Know when to bring forth each, because too much mercy is going to allow people to think that they can get away with things. Too much judgment is going to kill them. And that's it.
Hallelujah.
We're almost there, folks.
Almost. Shalom, shalom, everyone.
Shalom, shalom.
Greet y'all in the name of our creator of the universe, our master, y'all, as well as these mores up here. So I got three things I'm gonna say to you all, or share with you all, what y'all have been dealing with us in my personal house, as well as the Knesset up there in D.C. And something I was going to say when Adon started speaking, from the very first time he opened his mouth, I was going to say, none of us conferred with one another on what we was going to speak on. Nobody talked. Nobody said, hey, I'm going to wear this, I'm going to talk like this, and this is what I'm going to teach on. So everything that we have been saying, even throughout this year, has been consistent. People do have a ruach about them. And that ruach does determine whom they lend their azinu to, and they walk that counsel up, you know. So the first thing I'm going to say is that a word came to our house, and, you know, I heard God say, don't say that they will be, say that they are destroyed. So that's for the adversaries of the Torah and the Most High Yah. Whoever that may be for. Don't say that they will be. Say that they are destroyed already. It's already done. All right. And that's played itself out in more ways than one in the last couple of days.
Mm-hmm.
The second thing I was going to say is Ezekiel 13.
Mm.
Ezekiel chapter 13. We're going to start at one. So keep in mind, we're saying everything that all the Morays have been saying, all of the servants of God have been saying, has been in agreement with one another. Right. When Adon spoke about the figs, how does that vision start off in Yirmiyah? How did y'all start speaking to Yirmiyah with that particular vision? He asked him, what does he see? Simple. He said, what do you see? See? And I will ask you all to ask yourself that question. What is it that you see? And a man, what is it that you see? Because a man's actions is going to be the witness of how he perceives his creator and the Torah. So people are watching me, watching you. And most importantly, you know, the heavens and the earth are watching. You know, I had a brother and sister say, you know, put that on record. And I laughed with my wife after the fact. But then we were kind of grieving our ruach because of this, that they were saying put something on record, and they meant like record the conversation we was having. I said, they don't even know.
It's already
they were invoking the book of remembrance on themselves. So when they come back, y'all gonna say, well, didn't you say put this on record? And most say, just as Adon brought up, Adon said, he said, you're a witness against yourself. Moshe said, okay, beyond you, I'm going to call heaven and earth. Right, because heaven and earth is not going to pass away. At least it's going to outlive all of us. So even if I decide to fade away, join another group, change my name, change how I'm dressing and all that, you know what I'm saying? There is a remembrance of who I was and who I am now, no matter these facades we try to put on. But let's go to your Ezekiel and read a look and see what's actually transpiring in this day and time amongst our people. We start in verse 1.
Ezekiel, or Ezekiel chapter 13, verse 1. Then the word of Yahuwah came to me, saying, Son of man, prophesy against the prophets of Israel who prophesied.
Who?
Against the prophets of Israel.
So they didn't say nothing about no pastors, no churches, no Muslims, no imams, no Jews, no Buddhists.
Talking about our people.
And say to those who prophesy from their own inspiration.
We can stop right there, right?
Listen to the word of Yahuwah. Thus says Yahuwah Elohim. Woe to the foolish prophets who are following their own ruach and have seen nothing. O Israel, your prophets have been like foxes among ruins. You have not gone up into the breaches, nor did you build the wall around the house of Israel to stand in the battle on the day of Yahuwah.
Okay. Chapter 12 started off by saying, we dwell in a rebellious house. So what we said, I want to know, what y'all saying so far, just in chapter 13? Does this seem like it's written for today, right? Mm-hmm. A lot of false prophets, right? A lot of people prophesying out of there. Or, you see, it says prophesying, but people are speaking, which is what that means. They're not saying, thus saith the Lord or the Most High. They're just saying, they're just using the name of Yah without any inspiration. They haven't been led to do so. Mm-hmm. You know, they're giving you their desires and their will and their ruach. And the, because, you know, man, so much time to give y'all 10 minutes. You know, it says the Ruach HaKodesh runs from those who rebel against Torah. Mm-hmm. But you want me to believe you got the Ruach. but can't reconcile with your brother or your sister. Opposite murmuring, complaining, won't receive correction, meaning you a fool. Mm-hmm. See, but you got the Ruach. Everybody got, this ain't the church. Everybody don't have the Holy Spirit up there. Everybody don't have the Ruach, don't have a set apart spirit. You know, but only those who have been proven. And it's not saying that I am the standard per se, as it's to set myself apart from you, because it's one judgment for all. See, but what it is saying, stating is this, is that we have to be actively seeking a witness of the Creator in our individual lives and not our own interpretation of what this book is saying. See, and when we look on social media, you know, in our lives, and even some of us to some extent, we've been talking out of the sides of our neck. Mm-hmm. And as you said, it's high time that every man, soon enough, is going to eat the fruit of his own words. Mm-hmm. You know, so I encourage, that's really all I wanted to read in your Kesef 12, just to put that false prophet and his own inspiration in your Ruach. You know, because like I said, I want to know what you all see, and more importantly, you should ask yourself, what do you see? What is your criteria of righteousness? What is your criteria of fellowship, right? I asked a brother, I said, if you have Hebrew garments and a Hebrew name and zitz, and you say shalom, do I believe you're a Hebrew? Did it work like that in the streets?
Nope.
Man, that brother say he about something, but he don't even be putting no word in. Mm-hmm. See, right. And the conclusion I came to is this: is that there is a lot of calculation going on of people thinking and believing that they have the formula for something, and they have neglected the witness of their eyes to see. Let me see how Canuck walk this thing out in this situation. Mm. Let me see how he comes out. Does he come out not smelling of fire? And how about those that try to throw Lamad in the fire, or Ma'adon Samak in the fire, or you in the fire? See, so we gotta look at what are the fruits of righteousness pertain to what the Torah tells us, and the fruits of a man. You know, we talk about up there in D.C. that the fruits of a man are not only his thoughts, right, and his words, but those he fellowships with and leads to or from the truth. So, you know, we just got to begin to open our eyes and watch everything around us, because it's high time. The redemption that we seek has to match the persecution. You know, you're looking for, they like, yeah, we going to Israel, not without persecution. Which is going to lead me to the third thing I was going to say. So the first thing I said is that for the wicked, they are already destroyed. Right? Even though they might be walking around and all that, still showing up on Shabbat, they're already done. The second thing I was going to say is, guard your heart, because out of it flows the issues of life. And obtain a witness for yourself that the Creator is true. That no man can take from you. Because there's a lot of people with itching ears and every wind of doctrine, they just blowing in the wind. And then the third thing I was going to say, which leads into that, is does anyone know the word for tribulation? Any brief? Maha, heard you fluent? Fluent in Hebrew? What's the word for tribulation? Tribulation? Any brief? Or adversary? Other than translation. Yatsar. Or Zar, Yatsar, Y-A-T-S-A-R. Yatsar, tribulation. It's also the word for narrow. So when we talk about, Adon gave a lesson a while ago about who has an open mind. Everybody was like, me? I got an open mind. He's like, well, that's not good. T is actually the word for broad, is the way. So many are the interpretations of the way to destruction. See, but the reason I wanted to bring out the word yatsar for tribulation or for adversity is because that is the path for the righteous to go through the trip, to go through the fire. Whatever it is that we all may be facing in our individual lives that we are neglecting to do, we must face that because that is what's necessary for us to proceed to the next level. As a Knesset, this is the Knesset. This is the fire, right? As I said, this is the Mishpacha. You know, so that's all I have to say. I pray it was a barakah to increase. Right. And the last thing is think about how Torah will look to the next generation. How y'all are being. And judges. Yeah. All right.
All right, so one page, I promise you, it's just one page. And I made the font pretty big, so it's kind of like a half a page. Just so you all understand where we're going from. But what I like, you know, what's interesting was when they had him all up on the computer, if you know him a couple of years ago, he didn't know nothing about a computer. He didn't know nothing about a phone, nothing. I said, wow, this guy did feel pretty good. Yeah. So, you know, it's interesting that everyone's message seems to be the same. Dealing with individual, dealing with yourselves, dealing with as a group, as a whole, and it happens to be a little bit the same message I have today. And so what I want to talk about a little bit is, as most of them have already talked about, which is a house. So if I say what's a house, you guys would say what? Bet. Bet, for house. But if I say, can y'all name some places that's called a house?
Okay, your shelter.
So your shelter, place you reside, what else?
Body.
Okay.
We are.
Okay. Temple.
All right. So I want us to see that a house is, we're a house, right? Okay. There is a, collectively, we're a house, like the house of Israel, the house of, okay? There's a place that we come together, it's a house. Everyone understands that, right?
All
right. But it's a place where also it houses something. Two things that it houses. It houses light, and it houses
darkness,
okay? So if we're all trying to come together as one house, we got to start thinking about, are we a unity? Are we a cod? Okay, so if our light, if the light that we have within us, it starts to shine out and we come together, hallelujah. But we start to fight against one another, something is wrong. That's what I want to get at. So the root of the word for bayit, right? The root of that word is bana. Bana, right? What does bana mean?
Build,
also rebuild, repair. Okay, these are things that we need to start understanding because we're trying to come together. I saw on Facebook, I don't do too much TV, but I saw Facebook when Trump became president. My goodness, a bunch of people crying, violence. Notice that it was an uproar, there was a divide. Okay, and then that divide. Why do you guys think they were crying? What did they see taken from them? And their mind.
It's the gravy train getting ready to split.
Gravy train getting ready to split. Okay. What else? I don't know one in here cried. Right. Everyone else is here, right? Okay. Good. All right. So why do you think they were crying?
They put their hope
in man.
Okay, put their hope in man. What else? Someone have
any? I thought all the sadness and all the tears was about the recognize the true self of Trump became president, that racism is alive and well in them.
Okay, it's alive. Okay, yeah. So, the thing that I took from when I was looking at it is, that shows you just as the United States, I'm going to call the United States as a house. It's really a mutt. All right, but my point is that it's divided. And we're in it, and I saw some, not all, you know, just some place I saw on Facebook, even some of the brethren was, the sisters was crying. Mm-hmm. And I'm trying to figure out, like, man, I don't want to ask them on live Facebook, you know, because they might, you know, I might start some problems. But I thought about it as me and Baruch was talking outside, but I was like, but if Elohim's our king, what's the problem?
Right.
You know, so they start to move the Most High out of the way because it's sometimes it's, I don't see him all the time, so he's not kind of there, but whatever you see live is the issue for some people. Mm-hmm. All right, so just keep that in mind. All right, so the other part we talked about, which I heard earlier, was how many of us used to go to church? Okay. Man, we just started. So y'all can answer this question. What is church hopping?
Church. This one no finion, you go to the next. That one no finion, you go to the next.
Okay, so the reason why they're hopping is because of what reason? Different doctrines.
Yep. Correction.
Correction. They don't like what's being told to them.
Yes. So
I know that happens. I know that happens in the church. My question is, I know it doesn't happen among the Hebrews.
What?
So we have to start realizing that there has to be a change within us, and that's what I'm going to talk about a little bit today. All right, so Matthew's real quick, I'm only going to go maybe three or four places, and that's it. Matthew's chapter 12, verse 25, 26, and then I'm going to jump down to 29 and 30. Matthew chapter 12, verse 25, 26, 29, and 30. That's it, just those four words.
Matthew, chapter 12, verse 25. And knowing their thoughts, Yahusha said to them, any kingdom divided against itself is laid waste, and any city or house divided against itself will not stand. If Shaitan cast out Shaitan, he is divided against himself. How then will his kingdom stand? But if I cast out, verse 29, or how can anyone enter the strong man's house and carry off his property, unless he first binds the strong, and then he will plunder his house? He who is not with me is against me, and he who does not gather with me scatters.
Okay, what do y'all get out of that first? I know that. He read a good translation. Some of y'all was using that trusty King James. What did you guys get out of that? And it's okay to steam? I got 10 minutes. I just started. Huh? Anything? Divided? How does that work?
Well, first of all, if you're going to come together as a group, an organization, or a house, you can't have two documents.
Okay.
If you have two doctrines, we have to work it out. We have to, the minute that you start with two doctrines, you're going to have two pushes. And two pushes cannot exist at the same time.
Okay.
So you have to work it out. You have to come together in order to be strong. If you don't, you will be weak and someone will come in and take over.
Okay. Anyone's going to add anything to it?
Yeah, you got the Torah, you got the Most High laws, statutes, commandments, and anybody that don't stand with him stands against them. And if you're not with him, you're against him. And nobody can bind a strong man or come against his house and take him unless they bind him first. So first you have to stand with him. You have to stand in his household and be whole. Until then, we are not of his, we are fighting the Most High.
Okay. You know, I can tell you much of Hebrews. When you ask a question, they're going to be right to the scripture. Listen, what is just a divided house? What is that?
Well, two people don't agree. Huh? They talk, two people don't agree.
House that's okay, good. What else?
They don't agree.
They just don't agree, right? And the Zacchaeans, they gave great answers, but I want you to see that first we need to understand literally what is a divided house. You can start in your own home. You know, I can probably share my home a little bit. You know, I'll come out of my house. You know, since this was long time ago, right? So, there's some times where, you know, we're not seeing eye to eye.
Right.
The house is
body.
Okay. Now, what made it divided was what? Opinions. What else?
Miscommunication.
Miscommunication. Because a lot of the times, if you can't communicate right, you're going to be divided. Okay. Sometimes, I always share this, you know, when we do some counseling, sometimes two people can be right, but one person may want their way to go first, or their way versus your way, but they could both be right, right? But the problem is because of that they think they're divided. My point is that if we're divided, we could never come together. Mm-hmm. If we stay divided, we could never come together.
How can two walk together except
they
be in agreement?
That's right. How can two walk stay in agreement, right? So we have to start considering. We're all coming together here to be echad. I'm hoping we're coming to be one, to be united, so to speak. I hope that's the objective. Okay. Time, if you're not checking out the times, things seem like it's wrapping up. Seems like Jacob's trouble is just on the way. You know, so if you're not there, I suggest you get there. All right? But just keep that in mind. So I'm going to keep going. Now, how many have heard this here? I guess I'll read it in Hebrew first, and then I'll have you read it where this is located. It says, Hine, my toe. Uma na'im shebet akim gam yachad. Anyone know what that means? Okay. Psalms 133, verse 1. Psalms 133, verse 1.
Tehillim or Psalms, chapter 133, verse 1. Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together in unity.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, is that true?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So the word there, pleasant or delight, is a good thing. The other part is, it says dwell. Is some may get that misconstrued with Shabbat, but it's really from the root word yeshav, okay, which sit, settle, or reside.
Mm-hmm.
But how can we do that? Okay, we got to first have a delight. If I don't have delight, if I don't have that for you, it's not going to be pleasant. We're going to, just like I go back to the home, because I know everyone probably have done this, even to your children, just in case you're not married. All right. Sometimes you walk across each other when you guys are mad. You act like they don't even exist. You walk by, turn, and they look the other way. What's going on? Right? We have to stop doing that to our own brother, let alone in the house, because I was going to share that it starts in your home, and then from there it comes out into another home, and then it winds up growing like leaven, but let's talk about that in just a minute. 1 Corinthians 1:10, and I've got one more place and we're finished.
Ooh. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 10. Now I exhort you, brethren, by the name of our Master Yahushua HaMashiach, that you all agree and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be made complete in the same mind and in the same judgment.
Okay, now think about it, says there be no what?
Divisions.
Okay. Dikostasia is the Greek word there, right? Be no, but also not just that, means no discord. Okay? So we're going to read that last in just a minute, but it also means it. So there's no division. We shouldn't have that, but we tend to do. But the point I want to have here is, it said complete, where it says, among you, it says, but that you be perfectly joined together or complete. Can anyone tell me what that means? Perfect. How many of us can be that? Some of you have to raise your hand, but you will in just a minute. Okay? All right. So what this is, because we're thinking of the Webster's Dictionary perfect, right? And we know that in the Hebrew also means to be someone that's upright. How many of us is upright? Some of us still got some problems, huh? Okay. When it's over, you know, they got some prayer time. We all get together. All right. So, but at any rate, you know, and in the Aramaic, it's poi gemira, which means to be mature or to be fully grown. Okay? So, in order for us to come together, we got to be mature. We got to be fully grown. We got to be upright. If we're not going to be that way, then we cannot join ourselves to someone that is. It won't work. Okay? Is everyone with me so far?
Very good.
All right. Mishlei of Proverbs 6:16-19, and then I'll close. Actually, I have to read that myself. So I'm going to read, I'm going to close with this. Okay, Proverbs or Mishlei chapter 6, verse 16-19. Proverbs 6:16-19. I'm going to say some things, and I'm going to give you some nuances to it. So it's going to be out of the somewhat scope of the syntax, but I want you to get the definition of what I'm getting at. Okay? So it says, these 6 things does Yahuwah hate. Yea, 7 are an abomination unto him. A proud look. Do anyone know what a proud look looks like? No? No one? I know no one does that here. So. No? No? What, so, since none of you guys are that, what does it mean when you read that?
Donald Trump.
All right. So, proud, you also can find a nuance that word is someone that's loud.
Mm-hmm.
You know anyone like that? Mm-hmm. Wants to exalt himself. All right, great. So, I know no one's here, so we're good.